something that you don't understand that I say, please interrupt me for me to try to make you understand. So 20 years ago, this is one of our dilemmas. Does people who use drugs must be punished by using drugs? And the punishment that usually is being arrested was in having a good effect on the people or not. So if you go to the general population and you ask them, the majority of the people would like them to be arrested. But the problem was not being resolved. It's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So we have to think with other strategy to engage that situation. So because of the first thing that we've made was treatment programs, probably like all of you in your countries. But there is a problem. There is a lot of people that don't go to treatment because they don't have the will or they don't want to get out of the using drugs. So we started to implement harm reduction policies in Portugal with a humanistic approach, a very comprehensive model, looking to the individual as a whole in a holistic way. Based on these concepts about being pragmatic, complementarity, being gradual in our intervention, and of course all the NGOs who works in the territory must be community-based, because it's very important to know the agents of the territory, all of them, including the guys who sell the drugs. The harm reduction in Portugal, it's applied to illegal drugs or legal drugs, is the same thing. And it's very important for us to go with an approach without any moral judgment. I was thinking that the majority of the homeless people are using right now harm reduction facilities, okay? In Portugal, we have this kind of wide range model that we try to give a lot of, in the same place, we try to give a very wide range of activities and fulfilling the needs of the people, for them not to have to go around all over the city getting their needs. So it's the majority of our harm reduction structures are very robust in terms of wide of range of the responses. If we look at the homeless services, the homeless services is not so robust in terms of wide range of activities. And this is a problem because a big majority, all over 40-50% of the homeless people are also people who use drugs. Okay. So we have two kinds of first line equipment and a second line equipment. The first line equipment, usually outreach teams and consumption rooms, although there is in the law, we only have one consumption room in Lisbon, and it opens last year. But these activities are more centered in the fulfilling of the health needs of the people who use drugs. And then we have the second line of equipments. They are equipments much more concerned with the health situation, but also the social situation that the people are experiencing. So probably the most robust, the most important things that we have in Portugal are the kind of drop-ins. We call it another thing, but it's a kind of drop-in, because it's a very wide range centers of support. In Portugal, we have one consumption room in Lisbon that is what we think is a biopsychosocial model. And now in Porto, we are, maybe next year, we are opening our first consumption room, but probably will be an aseptic room. And this is a problem because we know that aseptic rooms does not work so well as rooms that have an approach more comprehensive. Okay, so when you think about day centers and shelters, day and night shelters, in the we try to make a little questionnaire between our Portuguese partners, the NGOs they have, which we have the shelters, and we try to understand how they are prepared to receive people who use drugs. And we ask them, okay, how many of you in the shelters have syringe program? And the majority of them doesn't have syringe problem. Then I ask them another thing. Okay, do you know that your users usually use drugs in your facilities without permission? And they say, okay, we know that. And my second question, okay, where do they put the material, the consumption, the needles? They don't have specific place to put them. Okay, they put them in the garbage, in the general garbage. So if you think there is no shelter in Portugal that is that have some disposal specific to needles. So do you imagine that a cleaning lady, when she goes to pick the garbage, can hurt herself, okay? Looking specifically for the friendly discrimination model in Portugal, one of the first question is taking drugs illegal in Portugal? And yes, it's still illegal taking drugs in Portugal. The way that we deal with the situation, it's much more different. It's not now a criminal situation because we feel that we have to give another kind of responses, but it's still illegal. So when the law was built, it was built also an organization, SICAP, that you see here. There is a small national health system is specific for people who use drugs. And why? Because people who use drugs didn't go to the National Health Service, because the National Health Service was quite rigid and not friendly for people who use drugs. So we create this organization that with a biopsychosocial approach, very comprehensive and very centered on the clinical needs of the people who use drugs. So in 2000, Portugal was one of the countries with worst indicators relating to health among people who use drugs. We have the high HIV incidence, one of the highest HIV incidence rates in Europe. We have one of the high incidence of Hep C, a big, big number of overdoses. So, and early death among the users. Although that, what you started to see was a lot of social annoyance and people starting to see a lot of social exclusion. So the criminality and the begging was starting to rise and being more visible in every Portuguese city. So the way of doing the thing was decriminalize the drugs. And what does it mean, decriminalize? Decriminalize, it's if you are caught using drugs, you still are doing a crime, but the crime is not punishable by imprisonment. So what do we do? We try to approach the guy, the user, into the system. The main objective is this one. It's to approach the person with a special push to this specialized supported network for him to have some knowledge about how can he treat himself if that is his wish. So this the punishment get out of the courts, and it was created a commission called the Drug Discourage Commission, CDT, the same in Portuguese, and CDT has one mission, is to when the police authorities get someone using drugs, they take him to the CDT, and the CDT have to make a diagnosis and try to evaluate all the support, the networks and family supports that the guy has. And then try to approach the individual to treatment, to informing and sensibilizing about the risks of using drugs, and try to identify what is the best clinical or harm reduction structure for sending for him to have some medical and social cares. What is the purpose of the law? The purpose of the law is discourage, but discouraging, looking at the individual like a patient, okay? Looking at someone who needs help, and the help is provided by the health and the social structures, not by judicial structures. So if you ask me if the majority of the users, the high-risk users, go to CDT, no. The majority of them doesn't reach to the CDT because the police authorities leave them. If they have a small amount of drugs, the police doesn't do anything. Okay, let the guy be over there using their drugs. The kids and the guys who the police identifies like not regular users, this one yes are going to the CDT. Since 2000, in the last 20 years, this is what we accomplish. If we're talking with overdoses, in 2007, we have 38 overdoses in all country. There was a year, 2015, that we have 6 or 7 overdoses in 1 year. And when we look to the new cases of HIV, we see only 1.5% is among people who use drugs. Hepatitis C, it's raising for the 55%. And when we look at tuberculosis, we see only that less of 5% is among people who use drugs. So the model it's very interesting and it works quite well. And it would work a little better if I think we have a very good response regarding to the health situation, but then we don't have a social, sorry, the clock was ticking. But we don't have a very robust social structures of support. So that is one of the problems that we have, and one of the problems of the decriminalization doesn't have much more success. So summing up, drugs are not allowed. There is no liberalization of using drugs. but we don't send no one to prison. We send them to treatment, to social reintegration, to harm reduction strategies and structures. And the idea is for discouraging the use, or if we cannot discourage the use, let's at least take care, well care, for the guys who use drugs. Of course, this law only applies to people over 16 years old. The others are still being dealt with the courts. Thank you for my 15 minutes.